name is Sally. I am a biologist at the American Museum of Natural History, where I study microscopic organisms. On Pondlife, we're going to go on a safari to explore the microbial wildernesses that exist all around us. I'm in the middle of Manhattan. I'm at the Harlem Meer in Central Park, and I'm here to look for a particular microbial community. It's a community that you might have seen before, but you've probably not looked at it quite like this. For most of human history, people thought of all life as being plants and animals, and the fact that species existed that were so small that you couldn't even see them was completely unknown. That all changed in the 17th century when a Dutch fabric designer named Anton van Leeuwenhoek invented the most powerful microscope the world had ever seen. I have a replica of his microscope in my pocket. This is it. This tiny little thing contains a really small spherical glass lens. And that spherical glass lens was capable of magnifying up to 300 times. So he would place whatever he was interested in on one side of the lens. He would look through by placing the microscope right up to his eye. So using this microscope, he became the first person to see unicellular life. And he first saw that unicellular life when he looked at a community of microorganisms called pond scum. And I can see a beautiful example right over here. Pond scum is a growth of filamentous green algae. And I've put some here on my Leeuwenhoek microscope. And we're going to take a look and see what he might have seen in the pond for the first time. Leeuwenhoek learned by looking through his microscope that the pond scum was made up of green algae that wound together. But what amazed him the most was that moving amongst that green algae were tiny little creatures. He called those little creatures animalcules, or little animals. These days, microscopy and our understanding of microbiology have come a long way. I have with me a modern day field microscope. Rather than a small spherical lens, it has an objective. An objective contains many glass lenses stacked one on top of each other. I'm gonna take a look at what we've got. At 100 times magnification, we can really see the details of this green alga. It's called Spirogyra. Each Spirogyra filament is one cell thick, about the width of a human hair. Spirogyra gets its name because inside each cell there is a long, thin, green chloroplast that coils and gives the organism its corkscrew appearance. Spirogyra, like all algae, live off sunlight. But when they grow in dense mats like the one in the Harlem Meer, the filaments on top end up shading the ones beneath. But Spirogyra has a way of dealing with this. The filaments are able to glide and they stay constantly on the move. This way, each filament will, at least for part of the time, have access to the sun. Just like Leeuwenhoek, we find many microbial creatures living among the algae. Here there are several species of ciliate. Ciliates are a diverse group of single cellular organisms that are covered in small hair-like structures called cilia. Each species of ciliate has a unique arrangement of cilia. This one has cilia only on the underside of its cell. It uses the cilia like tiny legs to walk about on the Spirogyra. This is one of the ciliates that Leeuwenhoek was first to describe. It's called Vorticella. Each is an individual bell-shaped cell sitting atop a long stalk. That stalk is rather special. It's a curious coiling contraption that can move like lightning if the cell senses any danger. The stalk also keeps the vorticella anchored so that it can use its cilia to generate a current in the water. The cilia are arranged in a ring around an opening in the cell that acts as a mouth. The cilia beat and drag water, bacteria, and other small microbes right into the vorticella's waiting mouth. This beautiful organism is a heliozoan, helio meaning sun and zoan meaning animal, though it's not an animal at all. The heliozoan is covered in many spike-like structures called exopodia, which radiate out from the cell's surface and act as a net for ensnaring prey. In real time, the heliozoan appears static, but under time-lapse, it really comes to life. A green cell is ensnared. Makes a lucky escape. The second cell is not so lucky. Leeuwenhoek was fascinated by organisms that moved like animals but were green like plants. This one is called Phacis. It's not an animal or a plant. It belongs to a completely separate group of organisms called the euglena. Its movement is due to a long, thin structure called a flagellum that extends out the front of the cell. The flagellum beats and pulls the cell through the water. You can also catch a glimpse of a red spot inside the phacis. This is called an eye spot. It sits at the base of the flagellum and can detect the intensity and direction of light. Like a plant, the phacis lives off sunlight, and this eye spot allows it to move through the water to wherever the light intensity is best. In that one drop of water, we just saw a wide variety of microbial species. In the whole pond, their numbers probably reach into the many thousands. And that's only scratching the surface of the amount of microbial diversity that we can find the world over. And to really get a handle on this microbial diversity, we're just going to have to keep exploring. I'm
gonna put these microbes back where I got them from.
Thank you.